This is the 11th annual Martin Luther King High School Remembers. Today, our junior class will be getting firsthand experience from our veterans. We'll be talking to some of those veterans today. As a participant back in 2010, I was really touched and moved by the veteran stories. So please stay with us. I'm here with John Corona, our leading man who started this program. John, can you tell us why you started this program?
Well, Hanna, we started almost by accident. Back in 2001, I gave an assignment to my U.S. history classes to go interview a family friend or family relative in relation to World War II in Korea. And a lot of the kids came back and said there was no one left to interview. Whoever they could interview had passed away. So I set about the task of recruiting veterans, getting more veterans to come and to speak to the kids here on campus. And so that first year we had 28 vets and 75 students, and it's just taken off from there. I've lost complete control of the whole thing.
Mr. Brooks, can you tell us what this program has done for our school?
It's done a lot for our school. It's brought a lot of pride, a lot of tradition, a lot of honor to our school. I see it really with two big main functions. One, in terms of recognizing and appreciating our many veterans for the work that they've done for our country. And then the second thing is bringing living history for all of our junior students, so that every year we get a group of King students that get a chance to come through and live history, you know, by interviewing a veteran and by understanding what it's all about. So it's a great program, and I think we'll probably continue it as long as there's a King High School.
Welcome to Martin Luther King High School and our Veterans Oral History Project, King High Remembers. I am John Corona. I am the project coordinator for King High Remembers. And it's an honor and privilege to welcome all of you here this morning to King High School. King High School Remembers is in its 11th year of existence, and we've had the great fortune of having close to 900 veterans share their stories with our students. Unfortunately, with each year, we are losing more and more of these vets to the rigors of time. This past year has been no different. To my left is a table dedicated to the memories of all those King High Remembers veterans who have gone on to the final roll call. They were men and women who selflessly served their country in time of war and their communities in time of peace. They are greatly missed. As Cadet Master Chief Petty Officer Kellen Kasem approaches the table for a final salute, I would ask for a moment of silence as I recite the names of those most recently departed. I ask that as we remember them, we remember those who never came home.
Well, good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to be here with you today and to witness what happens when the students have a chance to get to hear from the veterans some of the experiences they had. I don't know how many of you had a chance to notice, but just on the 15th of March, the flags at the schools in our country and flags in government buildings around the world that are connected with the United States of America were flown at half-mast. Just to share with you, in case you might not have realized what was happening, this was by proclamation from President Obama in honor of the passing of Frank Buckles, the nation's last surviving veteran from World War I. So I want to thank all of our veterans who are here today, their spouses, their family members who supported them, because we owe a debt of gratitude to them. Listen to their stories. You'll learn some remarkable things. It's well worth the time. And I commend King High School for continuing this program, for John Corona, for the work that he has done here. May this continue forward for many years yet to come. Thank you very much.
To all of you 11th graders out here, you juniors, I want to commend you for what you're doing. What starts out as a history project with Coach Corona has turned into something that's very important to the cultural fabric of our community. But thank you for doing this. It becomes a really important part of what Riverside's about, and particularly that this area, Orange Crest and Mission Grove, is such a new area to Riverside. When we think of how old Riverside is, that you're establishing traditions up here that are important to what Riverside is all about and the spirit of our community. Congratulations.
The main story is I was at Pearl Harbor when the attack happened, and I was telling all about that, and I brought some pictures and some of the stories that happened. And the main thing that I did, when the Japanese hit us, Marines were ready to raise the flag. Well, they when the Japs hit us, they dropped the flag right then. And after the initial attack, while we were in danger of sinking and on fire, and the captain told us to abandon ship. So as I was preparing to abandon ship, and most of the fellows did, the wind shifted and blew the smoke away. So the captain changed his mind and asked the people to come back because they said the California is worth saving. We could fight the fire, you know, give them quite a pep talk. So at that time, I just happened to see where the Marines had dropped the flag. So I went over and I raised the flag. And the fellows came back and they eventually got the fire out. And where's the picture? This picture was taken moments after the flag was raised. And a historian sent me this picture after he saw me at Pearl Harbor, knew I'd raised the flag. So he sent me this picture, said it was taken moments after the flag was raised. And here's the flag. That's me.
That's you.
It's like a ghost from the past seeing a picture of me at that time. So I really cherish that picture. And I'm giving it to the students here, and they can use that in their presentation that they make.
Well, thank you very much.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Thank you.
But then I went back to the vessel, and she was gone. The captain, they had called a damaged ship, and the captain had taken her and beached her. She was hit, and he had taken her and beached her on the beach. So then I pulled back to the dock with some oars, and there was an officer on the dock, and he asked me if I needed any fuel. I said, yes, I need fuel. And he says, around the corner, there's a fuel boat. I went around the corner with the fuel boat, got the fuel. Now when he come back, he says, now you're to patrol the water here around the Arizona and near here looking for bodies. So we did that all day long. Now you can believe this or not, the oil was that thick on the top of the water around there, and it was on fire. And the smoke was black, just black, it was hard to see at all. For about, I would say, a good 100 feet around the Arizona and the vessel and the rest of the ships right there in that area. We could see all the oil come out of those ships and floated to the top. And then they caught fire. And you can believe it or not, but this was burning right on top of the water. Well, that's one time that a life jacket was no good, believe me. Because we picked up a lot of guys for about 2 days, running them over there and back. Some of them were dead, some of them came up before. And I picked up one guy, I remember, we pulled him aboard and he'd been in that fire with the oil, and the jacket was burning. There was no way you could get at it to get it off. So anyway, we finally got the jacket off, but he was already burnt. He was already burnt clear to everything. Then this went on for another day or two, another day before they even let me. They kept me at this duty all the time. Well, when The third day, you know, when you're down in the salt water, especially in the harbor there, Pearl Harbor was a deep harbor. The current would come in and go down. Well, those bodies, it wasn't eaten up by the sharks. There were sharks in Pearl Harbor, a lot of them.
There were sharks?
They wouldn't let us even go swimming there without guys with rifles up there because there were sharks in it.
I'm here with Steve Fisher. Steve, can you tell us about what you're telling the kids today?
Okay, just kind of telling my military history. I'm a Vietnam veteran, 1st Marine Division. Spent March of 1968 to March of 1969 there. I'm just kind of going over a little bit of the history of what I went through over there. And as we continue on here, we'll talk a little bit about after I got out and in my civilian life. So, but it's the third year I've been here, and enjoy it every year. It's fun to talk to these students about what we went through, and hope they enjoy it.
Thank you. I'm here with Mike. Mike, can you tell me what you're telling the students today?
This is a picture of the submarine that I was on, the USS Bonefish. Actually, there was two bonefishes. The first one was the 223. This is a picture of the 582. The 223 was lost in the Sea of Japan in 1943 and was the second to the last submarine that was lost in World War II. They were lost with all hands, and we have no idea where she's at.
I was on what we called a fast attack, 637 class. When we went to sea, we'd pull the plug, so to speak. We'd go deep. Once we were out, we didn't come back to the surface, or we didn't surface again until we came back into port, which could be 60 days or more. It was continuous, where you were always paying attention to what was going on. Life on a submarine, you had to qualify in submarines. It generally took you a year to qualify in submarines, and you had to learn every system on board. And the purpose of that was because anything that happened, wherever you were, you might be the only person there, and you had to know how to save the boat. You had to know what system may have just failed and what valve, what to shut or open to make sure that everybody was saved. Or, you know, that the system was restored, so to speak, so nothing was lost.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name's Hannah.
Hannah, nice. My name is J.S. Ross. I was born with an initial name.
Can you tell me what you're telling the kids today?
An American salutes like this. The hand is turned down all the time. And the reason that hand is turned down, we're the only country in the world that was never defeated. Everybody else shows the hand. England, I don't care who it is, because they were defeated in a war. And I think that they'll remember something like that. And I ask them, how would they take a military base if they were up in an airplane even today, and you saw, look down, and you saw, oh, there's a military, how would you know a military base? Civilian bases, it's a flash. The light goes around and it flashes once time. But the military base, it flashes twice. Flash, 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 just like that.
My husband didn't go to school. He went to about the seventh grade. And when he was in the military, he was a pilot. His family was very wealthy at one time, and they owned airplanes. So he learned to fly at about 9 years old. So he wiggled his way into the aviation division. And one day his captain called him in, and he said, "Do I understand that you didn't go to school, didn't go to high school?" And he said, "No, sir, I didn't." He said, "Well, you get that blankety blank over to that high school," and he said, "I will commission you if you get your high school diploma." So he did, and from there he just sailed right up the line.
Well, thank you.
And we help support this,
But it's not just the funding that's important here. It's really getting the community involved that we're interested in.
Okay, I was going to Poly at the time, and I got drafted. And so I didn't finish high school. Till last year, we got our diplomas, okay? Really, and anyway, and I was drafted. I was inducted in Fort MacArthur, California. From there, they sent me to Camp Roberts, by Paso Robles, somewhere over there, for 17 weeks of basic training. After that, they sent us to Camp San Luis Obispo for amphibious training, because we were supposed to invade some island in the Pacific against the Japanese. In Belgium, the Germans counterattacked us. You know, not me, but I mean us. There was a lot of people, a lot of guys were killed. So instead of sending us to the Pacific, they decided my division will go to Europe to join that battle. Fortunately, when we got to Germany, over there, that battle was over. So ended up going into Germany itself. But we crossed the Rhine River. Heard of the Rhine River?
Yes.
Okay. But I crossed it in a pontoon bridge. Not only me, my outfit. Okay. From there, then we went to Dusseldorf, but we were in reserve. My regiment was in reserve. And then we only stayed, I think, 24 hours. They moved us to a town named Siegburg. Right by the Sick River. I think the Sick branches off the Rhine River. I'm not sure. I went to look at a map. You don't know where you're at over there. You just go. And from there, from there we attacked. That's where I got I call it a million-dollar wound. You know why? Why? Because it wasn't serious enough to kill you, to die. Just enough to get you off the front line for a while. Okay, that's what it is. Okay.
Hi, I'm here with Ms. Jackson. Can you tell us what you're hoping your students to get out of this day?
Yes. As our history teacher, I'm constantly trying to tell them, you know, history is real, and I want them to try to experience it, live the stories through the people in the books. But today brings history alive for them. It's authentic. It's real. They can see that history is about real people with emotions and feelings and passion, and I think they're getting that out of this.
Hi, I'm here with Tanner Wilson. Tanner, can you tell us about what you're doing today?
Yes, basically we set up at student registration early in the morning this morning to set up for the students to register and the veterans to register, and we've just been checking them in, seating them, and giving them food and water, just running around trying to feed them, and really just make them feel welcome here at King.
The wounds now in the present conflict are worse. These IEDs and other things, roadside bombs and all this, are just absolutely terrible. And I feel sorry for anybody that's there.
Hi, I'm here with Mrs. Bernard. Mrs. Bernard, can you tell me what you want your students to get out of this today?
I want them to understand that there's more to history than just their textbook, and that hopefully they realize what these men have done for our country and women have done for our country, and realize that, this is hard, that there's more to life than just them, and hopefully that message will carry with them when they realize that there's so many other things going on in the world, and they're just a little part of it.
Yeah. here, and it's our pleasure to dedicate this medley of service songs to you. Bryce, go ahead and start it. And on behalf of a grateful nation and an increasingly grateful generation, we want to thank you. When it comes time for your song, for your branch of the service, we'd appreciate you standing, so we can especially salute you. The first branch will be the Army. So if you're an Army vet, would you stand so we can acknowledge you?
Thanks to one and all.